special welcome today to the Toledo School of the Arts, who's here with us today. After a harrowing ride from Toledo, they made it. This is a grade 6 through 12 school, so we welcome them. Their first time joining us, hopefully not their last. Today we are thrilled to present, direct from London, Random International, a collaborative studio for experimental creative practice, specializing in participatory environments. We have the core of the group with us today, the three founding members, Hannes Koch, Florian Ortkrass, and Stuart Wood. Yeah, you're very lucky, folks, you're very lucky. And by the way, the music as you entered today was Max Richter, and the reason for this was that the Random International guys said this is the music that they steal for all of their work, so you'll probably hear more coming up. I want to thank our partners for their support of today's program, the University of Michigan Museum of Art, or UMA, and the Museum of Contemporary Art Detroit, or MOCAD, and Michigan Radio 91.7 FM. We didn't hear it today, but it is back, if you didn't notice. It's looking better than ever. The console is here. The console's finished. There's still about 1,300 wires to connect up into the chambers, connecting key to pipe, but we are assured it will be ready by next Wednesday, the 29th, as the Barton organ re-debut will happen under the spell of Stephen Warner, starring with the film classic Nosferatu. That's 7:30 on Wednesday, so I'd say don't miss it, and we can look forward to having the Barton back with us at next Thursday's lecture. Yeah, very exciting. I've missed it so. Tomorrow evening at 5 o'clock, the Creative Practice Work Group is hosting a special talk with artist and activist Steve Lambert. This is at the Institute for the Humanities. It's free for the public. That talk's at 5 o'clock. It will be followed by a reception, and you can meet the artist. Random, for anyone that has friends that are missing this today, and they are going to be so disappointed, and you can tell them, they can actually catch Random tomorrow evening at MOCAD as part of the Penny Stamps on the Road series. They will be speaking at MOCAD at 7 p.m. That's downtown Detroit at the corner of Woodward and Garfield. We will have a Q&A today, so you can meet these guys. It will be in the screening room, as we regularly do. So directly after this, exit the theater, go left down the hallway, and you will find yourselves in the screening room lobby. Go into that smaller theater and ask your questions. Next week, join us here again. We have a special and rare appearance. We will be hosting electronic composer and visual artist Ryoji Ikeda. Please do turn off your cell phones. Now, for the introduction of our guests today, I've invited someone who is new on the scene in our area. He's taken the post as one of our important regional cultural leaders. He's a native of Andover, England, a curator and writer whose interests encompass contemporary art and technology, design and experimental sound. He's none other than the newly appointed director of the Cranbrook Academy of Art and Art Museum. Please welcome Christopher Scotes.
Hi, it's great to be back in Ann Arbor. The last time I was here was in 1986, and I used to make frequent trips from Cranbrook to Borders Books. So, but those days are long gone, I'm afraid. But it's truly an honor to be here this evening and introducing Random International. It's not often that you get to say that a group of artists are really shaping the future of how we experience and see the world. Engagement with viewers through their various senses, and not at least movement, is at the core of Random's international practice. Working at the intersection of science, design, and art, Stuart Wood, Flo Ortkrass, and Hannes Koch are inventing and creating interactive, experimental installations by blurring the boundaries of high-end digital and analog worlds. I think you guys are in for a real treat this evening. It's a real treat to have them here. What I love about their work is that it's playful and inventive, demonstrating how art today may incorporate the latest developments in technology, while at the same time merge with other forms of expression such as architecture, music, and dance. The London-based trio founded their collective in 2002 after receiving their master's from the Royal College of Art. And as you're going to soon find out, they've managed an impressive list of projects, from a pixel roller, a paint roller that paints digital information in pixels, to an incredible installation at the Royal Opera House in London, where they position digitally guided mirrors that engage and follow the movement of the visitors. Super, super piece. But I think Random International's most talked about work to date is the immersive environment Rain Room from 2012, which was shown at PS1 in New York and was presented in the lot directly across from the Museum of Modern Art. The Rain Room offers the museum visitor the experience of controlling the rain. Well, anybody who spent any time in London, I know, has the great desire to do that, as I have myself. But Rain Room is a field of falling water that pauses whenever a human body is detected. As will be made clear tonight, experimentation and meticulous research are essential for their work. Using digital technology, Rain Room creates a very carefully choreographed downpour, simultaneously encouraging people to become performers on an unexpected stage and creating an intimate atmosphere of contemplation. Rain Room is by far the largest and most ambitious project to date, and again, what I enjoy about this work is that visitors are asked to explore the roles that science, technology, and human ingenuity can play in stabilizing our environment. You guys are in for a real treat this evening. Please help me in welcoming Stuart, Flo, and Hannes.
Thank you. Hello, Michigan. Hello, Ann Arbor. Thank you, Chris. Any questions? Because that was pretty much...
That's it.
Yeah. Our lecture. That was what it isn't. I don't know. Stuart, you had something. You have some business here. So that's Stuart Wood. That's Florian Ortkrass. I'm Hannes Koch. Of Random.
Can we get the house lights up?
Yeah, we need the house lights up for a brief moment. Yeah.
Now, everybody look like I've just told you something really interesting.
So it has to refocus. In the meantime, I would like to say a couple of thank yous. First to Christina Hamilton for inviting us, to Penny Stamps for making amazing lecture series to which we get invited. And lastly, to Maxine and Stuart Frankel,
I think
for being our studio's patrons, without whom we would not be here today. Title of the lecture is What It Isn't. What It Isn't, it's not a lecture, it isn't a lecture, about how grateful we are for the ongoing patronage of Maxine and Stuart and the Maxine and Stuart Frankel Foundation for Art. The studio has been working with them since 2009. And every time we installed a piece at the foundation in Michigan, there was this question of what's next? And while we've not looked back as a studio, I think we were always wondering if you did look back, Maxine and Stuart, because we at some point turned up with a piece called Rain Room, and that was the next piece. And well, I think afterwards nobody regretted it, but. Well, anyway, you've been the most amazing supporters of Random, and what it isn't wouldn't be what it's not without you. Here we go. At the moment, that's a couple of introductory slides. And that's also not what this lecture is about. It studies emotion. It's our only solo exhibition this year. In the Kunsthalle Lund in Sweden, where you're now actually looking at what it is, because this is what it isn't. It's the title of the piece, which you're looking at, and it's our first audio work. There will soon be some more information about this piece up on our website. It's also not about Twitter, but this is our Twitter handle, and we usually forget to talk about it, so I say it now. Follow us under @randomHQ, and this is the actual view from the Random HQ's roof in London, the gasworks. In part one of this What It Isn't lecture, of this presentation, we're introducing the studio and the practice a little bit in general, In the second part, we'll talk about two projects that we believe demonstrate a little bit about our process. In the third part, we talk a little bit more about what the work does to us as artists, and we also will briefly touch upon what is not yet, what isn't yet, current project and a few future projects. So we've been around since 2002. Indeed, formally we've set up in 2005, where we've known each other a bit longer, since the end of the 90s. We've studied together, undergraduate and postgraduate. This is where we're actually working. That's the real Random HQ. That's the three of us. We're 15 strong studio at the moment. Flo, Stuart, and myself share the artistic direction of all the work, and we realize our collective ideas, our collective vision within our respective teams. We've sort of dividing up some responsibilities within the studio. And yeah, we're diving straight into the work. We've started the practice, pretty much the studio, with a project called Pixel Roller, which you see here. It came out of the desire to build a machine, to build an object, which pretty much does what this object demonstrates, that it prints pixels, bringing the idea of digital. You need to remember that in 2005, when this came up, we started seeing a huge convergence to digital media, photography in digital form, so nobody had anything tangible in their hand anymore. And our desire was to bring this back into an analog, tangible realm, using paint to print out digital source data, images and text, onto real walls with real materials, with real paint. The amazing thing that a result was both the performative process, so you know, to watch an image coming out of nowhere, which sort of references this 50s cartoon style, and also the fact that you end up with absolutely unique representations of endlessly reproducible source data of black and white digital images and text. Every time you print this out, you get a unique result, so you can make beautiful series with this. And that describes our process quite well, I think, that to develop this paint roller, the pixel roller, the one which actually uses material, we had to resort to some prior testing, to some prototyping, in order to develop the tracking, the software, the mechanics, the translation of digital data into analog data, and vice versa, of the rolling over a surface into coordinates, which then can scan an image in a digital device in a computer. And this is light roller, so we had to start to think about the process of simulation somehow. This was still in university times. The idea was to simulate the printing process on a material that stores light and light-based information briefly, temporarily. This is a phosphorescent. So this project is light roller. It prints out digital data with light on a light reactive surface. This is just a little side note. This is the original size of a 2005 movie file from a state-of-the-art Nikon camera. So that's how quick technology progresses. So we did these projects, Pixel Roller. In particular, Light Roller was a commercial project for us in that we survived and lived off it, being performance artists, pretty much. So we studied design, so we were trained to make objects and then, you know, sell objects in masses and live off that, or give form to them. And we chose an entirely different path. We ended up not knowingly as performance artists for a while with these rollers. And then after doing that for a couple of years, we were always almost forced to be in the same place as our work was performed or shown. So we resorted to come up with ideas of mechanizing that process. Very much with this digital analog tension in mind, with this printing process, which temporarily uses very digital technologies to show on very analog materials to temporarily show images, and did a bunch of temporary printing machines simulating the printing of imagery, and then at some point fairly soon in the game of self-image. This series of family of works is the first comprehensive exploration, I think, of this studio, where we did repeatedly worked on the same subject matter and started also, which was significant for the studio, on the idea of editions. This is the first printing machine. It takes your portrait and prints it out, and it was a first editioned work we've done back in 2008. This is a larger version, full body self-portrait, all of which, as you will see in a second, fade out after about 60 seconds. It's a blank canvas with a tiny pinhole camera. It recognizes when a human being, as two eyes and a mouth, stands in front of it, takes a photo, prints it out, and while it's printing, it already decays. So it's basically the art installation predecessor of Snapchat. Goes back to zero. That was in 2007. I'm really proud that I made that connection. This is how it looks now. It's a selfie machine, basically. That's what it was after last summer. People look at it and go like, oh yeah, it's a selfie machine. It takes your portrait, prints it out. Just on a side note, more technical, more for the art world people here, it's an interesting exploration for us on the notion of edition. So this guy here is the same edition as this one. While we take that very seriously for the people who collect our work, we do take the liberty of changing stuff if we think it's better, and then sometimes even go back to older editions and change those. This is how it looks. It's a very scruffy vine shot in the studio, our Christmas self-portrait, just to give you an idea of the image quality of the new one. Image quality wasn't so expensive. It wasn't so important to us when we started the series. It seems to be more interesting now, at least I find it more interesting, because what's interesting with this piece is that people find it very hard to let go of their self-image. They immediately grab their phone and they panic that the image fades out, they'll do it again, and you get a really nice almost physical engagement with the with this kind of installation, and therefore our thinking is, you know, the better the image quality, the harder it will be for people to let go, because these images are not stored anywhere, they'll just disappear. I think this is one family of works, and Flo will pass over to Flo to introduce a very different family of our explorations, a piece called Audience.
Okay, so this was the first time we really worked with the body and with other people. And there was a commission in 2008 by Wayne McGregor for the Royal Opera House. And the difficult thing with people is we're all weird. Like, it's very hard to estimate, like to preview what we do. So I'll let you watch this for a second.
What we do in the studio all day long. Watch stuff.
So this is a stop frame animation from the from 44 from a research couple which is called Heide and Zimmer, and it was called an experimental study of apparent behavior, and that's good. That's what I wanted to hear. It's because our brains are really good at everything we see, we attach emotion to it, especially movement. So no one can really watch this without attaching even maybe personalities to these circles and the triangle. And because, like, everything we look at on a daily basis, every second we do this, like, we look at something and our brain tries to make sense of it. And so that's why this works. And it works across culture for everyone on this planet.
So with audience, we said we want to kind of reproduce the feeling of being watched at. So you come towards this group, and suddenly all of them watch you. It's a bit like when you're the next person to enter a party, and everyone turns around and like, who's the next person? And we all do this because we try to figure out if the person that comes in is either a threat or maybe a mate or anything in between. So whatever that is. So the next step was like how to make them believable as guys. So we wanted people to create like a relationship rather than to say, oh, it's a robot or it's one of 64 robots that sit on the floor. This was one of the initial prototypes, just to see if we could actually mechanically do this. And you see, it does look robotic. It has nothing to do with being, I don't know, some kind of thing that has personality. And we created these. I always say they're glorified paperweights with a mirror on top, but really very abstract. So we have a metal base with a couple of servers, and then it's just an A5 size mirror, actually. So that's the paperweight. That's the electronics in the base, so they each know where they are. This is number 9. And then so we proved the concept, and then what we do, we needed 65 of these, so we made many. And then we tested them, that they all work, actually, and that they work together. This was actually already in the roll opera house, and Stuart will talk a bit about the thing that makes them work.
Yes, I will. Thank you. Hello. So, as Flo kind of talked about before, we do everything in-house in the studio. We kind of come up with concept and visualize it, as you saw, and then we kind of explore and figure out how that works, and we do that through electronics and software and stuff. And this is the first kind of chapter in our exploration of that. So this software was actually designed by a guy called Chris O'Shea, but since then we've kind of redeveloped it. But the idea is that you have all these little mirrors, and they've all got a little personality, and they look around, and that was all cool, and they look at you. And the way we did that was we had camera tracking on top with blob detection. So you'd have a camera looking right down into the space. All these little points kind of represented the little mirror guys. And then we had to figure out a really clever way of the software kind of figuring out that's a person and that blob over there is not a person. And what's the most interesting person? And the way I wanted to do it was to get an intern with a mouse and make him choose people at random and follow them. I was outvoted. Fine. It would have been a better way of doing things. However, we spent lots of time doing it properly. that was lovely. So this is just a software view of what's going on, and this is a real view of what's going on. So that part of the project, in some ways, was kind of easy. It was like just a set of design problems where we kind of it needed to all look, all these little mirror guys when you walked in, it needed to look at you. But the main problem we had is that we, in the state that it was kind of, they're all chatting to each other or having this kind of thing, we fell into a lot of problems with the original way we were going to do it. We were going to do it with like an algorithm that they would kind of walk, look around, and they kind of ended up looking like little drunk little guys, not really interested in anything. So we went back to basics. We kind of looked at people that do this nicely and well, like these guys. And we ended up just creating really simple animations. For example, this is chatting. You can see my knee. Very, very sexy knee, I can show. And this was all just done with a mouse and a very simple piece of software where I was basically there just with like kind of, that looks a bit like chatting and kind of moving the little guy around. Having a little daydream. Sleeping. Loudest thing in the world. My favorite one. Come on, guy. It is funny. Oh, it's not funny anymore. It stopped working.
Just go back and forth a bit, maybe.
Oh, this was going to be really good, but then it's just ruined everything. Saving. Contact lens.
There we go. It's looking for the lost.
Imagine that whole thing didn't work, and then you look at this and you go, oh my God, shoot, that's hilarious. Yeah. So it ended up being something like this. This is actually the piece that we have at the Frankel Foundation private collection. They were very curious about Flo there. It's probably his red top.
Is that about my socks or the,
yeah. What they do?
I think worth noting that Flo doesn't feel very observed there.
No, at all. I act very natural.
A little bit.
Yeah.
Against
he's never
our
seen
expectations.
It before. So they're cute, eh? Yeah. Hey, guy. Hey. Yeah, so that was cool. And they kind of did the thing, and we're happy with that. But what was really interesting about this, so this was a piece about modeling behavior. Yeah, it's kind of like we wanted to give these kind of like these little critters some kind of emotion and kind of existence. But what we didn't really realize, we kind of had this kind of anticipation of people would walk in, they'd all look at you, and you get freaked out, and you walk away again. However, no one did that. And we kind of gained these fantastic little insights into people's personality, like this.
We didn't pay him for this.
Yeah, that was not staged.
You saying that makes it sound like it was staged. It's not staged.
Could you stay? You couldn't stage that.
No. So this is nice. So this has actually ended up being something way more than what we initially intended. We had lots of videos like this as well. It was kind of, this guy's the funniest. He's also got a really cool pink jumper. So that kind of, you know, this idea that we were modeling behavior and then actually we were gaining this new behavior from people watching the pieces really kind of was something really interesting in that work. And then Flo will talk about as well. Good lead in.
Excellent. Okay, we always get asked, when reporters run out of questions, they always ask, oh, so where's your inspiration coming from? And they always expect like a list of 52 artists, and we have the pieces, and it's like, and it's most of the time it really comes from life, and sometimes you don't know where it's coming from, but this one came from looking at starlings, and the fascination about how this works. I don't know if there's no reports about some of them actually crashing, so they're doing this really well. So how can we encapsulate this into a 3D object? And so we looked at how each member reacts to the position movement of other members in a swarm. This is a model from the who first tried to explain how this behavior of a decentralized self-organized system works. And then there's the internal behavior, which is keeping a distance to each other of each individual member of the swarm, the directional alignment, and trying to be in the center of others, which kind of makes this work. And then we included like external behavior, and there's two main behaviors of a swarm. One is looking for food, kind of cruising around, and one is being scared from predators. I'm sure you like have at some point watched a school of fish, where like a predator goes in and they all disperse. So in the final software, it's always really important that we can make life changes, because you sometimes see really quickly if something works or doesn't, and how to make it feel right. And then it needs to. Then we get into the physical, where there's no Apple Z or undo anything. So we actually have to make these. And in this case, it involves a lot of manual work and attaching each of these light points to three brass rods. And the brass rod does something really nice. It creates the structure, but it also supplies the electricity to run it and the information, like who of them, which one should go on and off. And so that's the first cube we assembled. And so the important thing with this was that you want the distance of the cubes small enough, sorry, the distance of the nodes small enough that when the light moves through, the brain actually thinks that lights are moving through rather than individual lights switching off. So we kind of, and you want to see as many light points as possible, so it needed to be very transparent, and this worked very well. So with it being a very rough resolution, let's say, like we're very good at looking at this and actually thinking something is moving through.
Talking of stealing music from Max Richter, the ingenious composer who we've since actually worked with. But this was one of the first films where we thought, that's really nice music. And we really did try to license it, but it didn't work, so we had to steal it. Can't remember why that was. This family of swarm lights, the sort of simulation of natural behavior, you know, you don't develop one process and then just, you know, make one piece out of it. And we're very happy that we've developed a whole family of swarm studies. This is a giant one, very large, four bit cubes running a very similar, same algorithm, using a different interface to motion or movement or to the public. So this is using camera tracking, where the previous one in the film you've seen that Tom claps. So that has a sound interface. This one is actually using top-down camera tracking. You can see it in the sort of between the two cubes, you see a little black dot. That's a camera which looks at people. It's at the Victoria and Albert Museum in London. So people walking underneath, they get picked up by the camera, and then this swarm subtly attaches to them. Or not. It's sort of it happens not entirely randomly, but it's a very subtle interaction. It serves to try. It's an experiment, an attempt to open up this behavior to a sort of response from the viewer, or from people who view that interaction, and then see what happens. Then we've earlier this year, started looking into different color temperature for the light into a different scale for this. So this is a tiny one, this mini swarm. It's about this big, has warm white LEDs. It's a very dense configuration of the piece. And we've gone entirely, a few years after doing the swarm, we've used the same process or technology for something entirely different, for a very different kind of sculpture, but again, referencing ourselves or using something we've developed to achieve a very different thing. And this is a piece called Future Self, which doesn't simulate natural behavior. It actually mirrors behavior. So it serves as it's best described by a very prototypical film. This is what it does. It picks up your full body image after having worked with audience on sort of very crude body detection and on two-dimensional self-image, this is the sort of full package where your full body, your full being is represented in light with a slight ghost mode, ghost delay. And this is called future self. And yeah, there's a little bit more about this piece later on. Culminating, well, these all these sort of areas and explorations then two or so years ago, at least publicly, culminated in this guy in a piece called Rain Room, which Stuart is going to introduce to you.
Ta. I can see you all admiring my dance moves back there. Yeah. Thank you. Yes, so this. Okay, so this was Rain Room. Oh no, there's another bit. Yeah, look at that. Thanks, guys. enough of that. Jesus. I was going to say that, but now I don't have to because the video said it. But yeah, Maxine, Stuart Fangton. Awesome. Rain Room. So Rain Room. Rain Room consists of 14x7 1 meter tiles. Each tile has 16 solenoid valves, which allow roughly 25x25 centimeters of section of water to rain or not. Which I don't know what that is in inches. You work in inches, it's stupid. Which is 100 square meters again. You probably don't know what that is, big. We have a pump delivering 1,200 liters per minute. It's a recyclical system. We treat the water so you don't get like diseases, which is excellent. There's control mechanisms and a computer running custom software, processing data from 8 time of flight cameras that basically see you and stop it raining on you. It's basically plumbing and magic. The piece is actually more than plumbing and magic. It's in the entire environment. Every time we've shown it, we've shown it twice. We've shown it at the Barbican originally and then here at MoMA. The piece is very carefully curated and very fine-tuned. It's essentially a theatre stage in which you kind of end up being the actors. Like audience and swarm before it, you know, when we were creating a modelling behaviour and giving those to inanimate objects, we found the most interesting thing was how people reacted to these objects. So with Rain Room, we came at it from a different stance, is that we wanted to kind of create a social experiment. And we had a lot of ideas about how people would react, and then now we've shown it twice. I'm going to kind of talk through how people have reacted. So yeah, it's water. A very good friend of mine walked right up to the piece as well. I showed it to him, and he goes, "It's not real water, though, is it?" Like it was some kind of optical illusion that we'd kind of spend a lot of money and time putting into. No, it was real water. I did tell him to run through it and see how optical illusion it was. people were like ducks. You know, one in, they're all in. And this was helped by the media frenzy based on it. The sound actually was incredibly tremendous. It was, like, again, something we had an idea about, but until you create something. I'm a firm believer of you build things to understand them. I think it's a really interesting philosophy we definitely hold in the studios that, you know, ideas are ideas, but until you build something, until you have it in your hands or you're in the thing, then you can finally understand and tune and figure out what these things are. So the sound was really intense, really, actually really therapeutic. It was almost like these waterfalls they have in New York City. That sounds mental. It's a thing. Kids got wet. Hilary Bears. As did men in cheap black suits. No fault of my own, but the time of flight cameras we used tend to, the light got absorbed by black, terrible polyester. One interesting fact about this, though, which I find hilarious, is that they seemed to like. I observed quite a few of these guys kind of going in, and it just not working. They would just get drenched immediately. But they were like just walking around, not like me. I would go in and go, oh my god, it's wet, and then I'd run away again. They were just like, it's working for everybody else, is it not? Is it me? Should this be a thing? Like, I'm just walking around normally, just getting drenched. Like. I found that amazing. Like, they were like upholding some kind of thing. just funny. People have a lot of blind faith in the thing as well. You know, that guy's got like a 10 grand plus camera and he's just in the middle of it. Like, it wasn't even a thing. He just walked straight in, blah, blah, blah. Like, we assumed people would be scared. We originally, with the Barbican, it was a very narrow space, and we actually intentionally designed it that there was a point at which you couldn't walk around the piece, you had to go through it. And I just assumed, or we had an assumption, that people would be afraid. They'd go in, they'd go, oh, that looks nice, but I'm not going in that. People just piled in like it wasn't even a thing. It was actually quite phenomenal. And what they tended to do was just kind of take pictures, lots and lots of pictures. I do like this quote. And Instagram it they did. Yes, they did, in their droves. Many, many Instagrams. But that was lovely as well. You know, one thing about being, what I enjoy most about this job is that there's a flexibility within the team that we work in, and usually, hopefully, the people we work with as well. So in this case, when we originally designed and installed Rain Room at the Barbican, we had a lighting plan. And it was very different to what this ended up looking like. And terrible, got to be honest, terrible, terrible idea. It was to do with fluorescent lights on the side. And we did it, and it looked all right. But then this film crew came like a day before we opened to the public.
It looked like a rainy parking lot. I'm sorry.
Yeah, it did look rubbish. And they brought this HMI, this kind of like daylight simulation. And they switched off our light, switched that one on. And I was just like, ah. That's brilliant. Okay, and then I had to phone up like Hannes and Flo and Jane Allison, the curator, and said, yeah, no, you know all that money that we just spent on all that other lighting? Nah, screw that. We need to take that out. We need to put one of these guys in. And we did, you know, and it really made the piece, actually. And it's having that flexibility, like even at the nth hour, which was so important to the piece.
We have really good working lights now.
Yeah. Made good use of those guys. We've had two proposals. This is kind of nice. Gross. It's gross. It's not nice at all. The cues were really exceptional. Something, again, have no anticipation about this. And something that, you know, it took a life on itself as well. You know, friendships were formed, drinking games were played, pizzas were ordered. Pizza, yes. Domino's, can you deliver to the Rain Room queue? Yes. And they did. It was great. Which was fun. This shot was taken at the penultimate weekend of the Barbican showing. This kind of snaked back and back and back and back. And the guys that came at 11 o'clock in the morning when it opened were told, we're closing the queue now because otherwise we won't get everybody in. It's kind of nice. Crazy, like, who would want to queue up for that? I wouldn't. I'd be like, no, nothing's going to be that good. But they did. for all, no, not for all, so lovely people. There was even fantastic advice on the internet about how to deal with your children from Mumsnet here, which is fantastic. And a really great story about a guy who placed an ad on Gumtree, which is like a, I don't know what's that like, it's like Craigslist in the UK, asking, for, and he paid a guy £100 to stay in the rain room crew for him for 4 hours, though he could walk in with his girlfriend and really impress her. I could have done that. We didn't. We should have monetized this, but we, you know, that would have been definitely, I would have definitely taken that kind of thing. Con los terroristas. We don't endorse that kind of behavior. Rainception. I like that. Yeah. That was another fun fact about MoMA. We had it in a tent outside. It leaked. The tent leaked more than the piece did. And unfortunately, no. The part of it was the queue. It was not an enforced queue, but people wanted to go in, and we couldn't, let everybody at the same time, or the whole thing would switch off. So we had a certain amount. Unless you're your Beyonce, and Jay-Z, and some kid. Someone they picked up. I don't know. This is one of my favourite kind of outputs from the piece, actually. This was a blog by this Kate Gaving, or Gavino, which was Eve Droplets, overheard in the line for the rain room. I like this one. Maybe we should buy a membership. How much? 85? I don't like art that much. And this one, American Psycho can never be a musical. It takes all the magic out of the story. But it is a musical now as well. That's Rain Room. And it's what's interesting about it for us now, because we're still exploring this piece and things. It's different everywhere we've shown it, and we have shown it twice, but we're actually going to be showing it a couple more times in the future, and more. And it's different in each place. It's different with the culture of the places as well. It sounds different. The Barbican was the space was so echoey, and it was like a cacophony of sound. It's fantastic, whereas. MoMA, it was much more deadened and stuff. So and it smelled different. It smelled different with the water that they used and all this kind of stuff. So it's still interests a lot about exploring the piece. Still. But anyway, I'll hand over to Hannes.
Yeah. So 4 weeks after, we always got this question. So what do you do next when people were actually in the rain room when we just had opened a piece which we had worked for 4 years and. It was like, what do you mean next? So for weeks after we opened Rain Room at the Barbican, For 4 weeks after we opened it in the Barbican in November 2012, we were invited by the curator of the Ruhr Triennale, of the public art bit of the Ruhr Triennale, who said, come to this place here, Zeche Zollverein, it's called. It's in West Germany near Düsseldorf, Duisburg. It's an unused, disused coal mining area. It's enormous architecture. And they said, this is the public art place where the public art piece will happen of the Ruhr Triennale, which is a multi-arts performance festival which runs for 6 weeks every year. And she said, come here and do something. And we were like, cool. So this is not really houses or buildings. These are architected machines. They're absolutely mental, up to the sort of 8-9 meters height. They don't even have doors or an entrance. They're made for trains to go in, filled up with coal, and so on. And we said, okay, they invited us pretty much on the basis of having seen Rain Room and the queues at Barbican. So we said, no, we're not going to do anything to compete with this mental architecture in terms of scale, and we're not going to do anything with water. So this is what we proposed a few weeks later, because that is really what this space needed. So we proposed to make switchable and accessible architecture to counterbalance this kind of inaccessibility of these monumental machine buildings. So we wanted to do a temporary structure made of water, which we can in a very megalomaniac style control. You switch it on, it's gone. Switch it off, it's gone. You switch it on, and you are in control. And you can go into it. So the idea wasn't really to make it interactive, but to make it approachable. So you. Lucky for us, the owner of the of the whole mine, coal mine, falls under a special kind of law. It's not even German law. It's called it's a mountain law, mining law. And this is the only tower in the mine which is still in use. They have reason for using water. I need to add was that they have about 6 million cubic meters or something of water every year to get rid of in the disused mines. Otherwise, the whole area would collapse, and it's a huge area. So there was a lot of water on site. That's why we felt we have a good right to use it. Anyway, we weren't allowed to use that tower.
Luckily,
because what you've just seen wouldn't entirely have worked. We scaled it down slightly and then developed a piece called Tower Instant Structures, and Flo's going to talk you through
Interesting detail.
Yeah,
so it wouldn't have worked for a lot of reasons, but so we knew a bit of rain from Rain Room, but this was kind of a different thing because mainly because it was outdoors, which we took into consideration, but it's a completely different thing. So we needed to look at how the water is distributed, how quickly it falls, and how dense, and how you create laminar flow, and all this, and how much water we can actually get. This sits at the top and distributes the water. So we need to know to get the best flow out of all these nozzles, and if we have enough water. So we did simulations of the pressure and the velocity, and then we did this as well.
Prototyping.
This is the second prototype. The first one was just a bucket off the roof, and then we're like, yeah, that could work maybe, and we looked a bit further into what actually happens when there's wind, because outdoors maybe you have wind, so in terms of how big the drops are and how much drift you're getting, what weather we will actually have. In the end, we thought, well, we have all this information, but in the end, we just said, okay, let's just do it and see what happens. So this was when we arrived at the site. So this is the tubes that bring the water up to height. Our guy who arrived first at site just broke out into laughter, because it was huge, which didn't fulfill the team in Germany with much confidence. However, we said, no, this is fine. So we got ourselves a couple of four, actually, small pumps. And then we came and assembled the ceiling on the ground. That was where we said, okay, we have a bit of water. That works. One works. And then that was just before it went up. Then we got ourselves a little crane, two of them, actually. This is big for Europe. You probably have them all in your backyard as lawnmowers. But this is pretty big.
Big.
We're like,
yeah.
Whoa!
It would be grande.
And and then it was pulled up to height, and then it was attached to this. Landmark building, which we had to apply for each hole to be drilled in, and then we switched the water on, and it worked.
Yeah, I think it's there are a couple of qualities which are remarkable, and where this was, Rain Room really had a aesthetic quality, and also in its immersion, and it's in the experience when you were inside, you still had this kind of need. A lot of people experience the need to document that process. To the degree that if it's not on Facebook, it's not real. People weren't really in the experience. And that was something, I don't know, it's probably exaggerated to say that one gets annoyed by it. But you start questioning it because you don't really build a work like Rain Room for people to only photograph it. You build it for people to be in it. And what I really personally absolutely loved with this guy here was that it very nice sort of complements Rain Room in that here you couldn't document your experience. If you were in this one, you got absolutely drenched. You had to go through, literally, it was using water as a building material, not as an effect or as a sort of prop. It was using water as a material, and you got drenched, and you were... Sorry. Have to go. Where's the back button? That's when I do it from there. So, yeah, we had a few discussions about what I'm showing you now. We have not yet really properly documented tower.
However,
I think it's hilarious. I don't. I might be the only one in the room. Other people did. So we asked them to give us their film. It's clearly not Max Richter. Sometimes other people say thank you. Sometimes, see, at least some people get it. Sometimes other people see what you've done. This was a film made by the people who supplied the pumps. They're usually draining Holland of water. They dry up Holland and they make pumps for industrial purposes.
Which
and they documented
work.
Their bit. And they YouTubed it much quicker than we ever could. So why not use it? Hollywood, man. Mm.
They use different music when they have when they're in Holland. Yeah.
Okay, just very, very briefly to find closure in this lecture or in this presentation. We wanted to talk a little bit, which we usually don't do, but in this case we did. We wanted to talk about what it isn't yet, about pieces that we have in development, and about directions which we take at the moment as a studio, and showing you three snippets of works we currently have in development.
Okay, so we like big things. So this is like a nearly architectural style. Or scale version of future self. Who doesn't like big things is usually museums or collectors, because they usually have to build another building for our stuff. I'm sorry. This is in the planning for 3 years or something. At some point it went to planning, and then we didn't hear a lot about it. So this is like a skyscraper, and then kind of in which we will represent the human form. But so we hope this happens at some point. Architecture happens so slow. It's like we're always like, I don't know, for us a project that's 6 months is long. But so we hope this is happening soon.
Hello again. This is the thing we're exploring as well at the moment. This is a project we're doing with Harvard University and the robotics labs. So we went there and we saw these crazy robots and all this stuff. And they've also got, it's actually the BioMotion lab is in California, I think, actually. And this is something we've been exploring for a number of years. In fact, I did a degree project on it in 2002 about the perception of, you know, you can represent the human form and derive humanness, is that a word? No, probably not. From a very simple set of data, and in this case it's 15 points. Depends how much money we have in the end, whether it's going to be 15 points. So this is what we want to build. So the piece, 15 points, because it's made of 15 points. Genius. Recreates the movement of a human. We've got two schools of thinking about the piece at the moment. One is that the body has its own character or is its own object that you interact with, or the other way is that, if like we did with Future Self, it's you. The nice thing about kind of exploring at this early stage and virtually in some ways, we are doing physically as well, is that you stumble upon things which are actually even more interesting. So in this case, if you not only move the points, but move all the little object guys. Yeah. So we're kind of playing with that. Thanks. We're exploring that in lots of different ways. So this is some software that I'm writing to do, you know, complex motion based on different motors, and you can see the motor graph down here. And this is this is what it looks like in our studio at the moment, in a very raw sense. But this is very much how like we work with like the mirror guy. We chose the form of the motor arrangements because of its simplicity. We don't have to move much of a mass in the end, so we don't have to worry about that so much. But this is kind of how we work and what we're exploring at the moment in that sense. And then...
Yeah, I think the last project we've worked on is... we had quite a lot of thoughts about this fast-switching architecture. And this is a sort of indoors version of it. It's a maze. Again, it's not interactive. It's sort of has its own life, and it asks you to walk around in it. It's not probably not as brutal as this outdoor tower, but it's something we've currently have in development, and we're very much hoping to realize within the next year or two for the first time in that instant structure series. That was it from us. That was what it was, really. Thank you. I gather there will be a Q&A in a separate venue. Just if you're in LA next summer, watch out.
Don't get some.
Thank you.
We're there punching people in the face.